Get started with our afternoon session. My name is David Kurtz. I am from the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. I am a member of the planning committee for this workshop, and I will be introducing our afternoon speakers. Coming from the government, I might as well introduce the governmental speakers. So I'll just go ahead and we'll just dive right into it. So our first speaker this afternoon is Dr. Malini Wileman. Dr. Wileman is from the Food and Drug Administration.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much to the organizers of this event. Can you hear me? thank you very much to the organizers for the opportunity and the invitation to speak at this forum and discuss the regulatory considerations. Is that better? Okay. Especially following up so closely on the heels of the International Human Gene Editing Summit last week, it's really important and useful to us at the agency to continue to hear some discussions on the scientific and technical issues and concerns, and also continue to get familiar with the data and information that are out there in the field. So for my presentation this afternoon, I will focus on FDA's regulatory and statutory authority and also discuss the investigational new animal drug, the INAD, and the new animal drug application, NADA, review process that we use at the agency for the review of data and information for genetically engineered animals. I will also discuss a couple of case studies on how we may apply the INAD-NADA review process for the review of data for GE animal models of human disease. So the major federal statutes governing the regulation of GE animals at the agency, so this would be at the Center for Veterinary Medicine at the FDA. The major federal statutes are the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act, under which it is the products of biotechnology that are regulated, not the process itself. And also the National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA, comes into play because the approval of a GE animal is a major agency action. So there is an environmental assessment required for the GE product. the relevant sections of the Code of Federal Regulations, the CFRs, that contain information on the new animal drug provisions of the Act are 21 CFR 511 and 514. Now, 511 discusses the new animal drug provisions as they may apply to investigational animals containing the new animal drug, and 514 contains the new animal drug approval, the application process and requirements therein. The regulated article may be one that is intended to alter the structure and function of the body of man or other animals. So in this case, we regulate GE animals by regulating the rDNA construct at a particular location in the animal. And all GE animals must have an FDA approval before they can be introduced into commerce. Now, an exemption is made for investigational animals, wherein, and so this is explained in 21 CFR 511, I mentioned, wherein a sponsor of an application may ship animals or animal derivatives to another researcher for investigational purposes. But for the actual approval, a sponsor of an application must demonstrate safety and effectiveness of the regulated article, and in the case of food animals, also demonstrate food safety. The guidance for industry 187 that was published by the agency in 2009 actually clarifies the statutory and regulatory authority that I just covered in the previous two slides. So The footnote here actually contains the website where all the relevant definitions and links, references, and the actual guidance are also located for your reference. So FDA regulates all types of GE animals. These would be GE animals that contain heritable rDNA constructs and also non-heritable, the latter, for instance, being gene therapy in animals. So we do regulate both types of GE animals. each DNA insertion is considered an event and is regulated individually. So all GE animals derived in the lineage would be considered under one application. The guidance also contains a lot of details on how sponsors may submit data and information towards their application under the INAD and NADA process and any and all sponsor responsibilities in the post-approval arena as well. So by now you have seen several presentations that discuss the process of gene or genome editing using a variety of editors, whether it is zinc finger nucleases, the TAL effector nucleases, or most recently the CRISPR-Cas9. So I will not go into the details of the technology itself, except to say that we would be interested in what is the molecular change that is happening. So whether there are targeted insertions that are involved, or whether there are small or large mutations, whether they be deletions or substitutions. Now, there is some perception in the field that these are not necessarily genetic engineering events, that this use of this technology is actually non-GE, and some of that may be due to the terms that are used in the field as well, some of them interchangeably, whether you're saying transgenic, genetically engineered, genome editing, or edited. So these terms are sometimes used interchangeably. Sometimes they're used to describe the nuances and the differences between the terms. But be that as it may, the term or the name or the description of the technology in the field is not what we would consider a regulatory trigger that gets the FDA involved in the regulation of the product. So for us, the regulatory trigger is the drug definition. That is in Section 201 of the Act. so here I have actually indicated all the drug definitions, including the two people are mostly familiar with. A drug may be articles intended for use in the diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, or prevention of disease in man or other animals, or articles intent other than food intended to affect the structure or any function of the body of man or other animals. So for us, we always go back to the drug definition and see how that would apply to a GE product. So the question then becomes, how does this translate for genome-edited animals? Now clearly, genome editing technologies are intended to affect the animal's DNA by altering the DNA sequence encoded in the animal's genome. For insertions of DNA, again, this would refer back to few slides ago I was talking about the regulated article being the rDNA construct at a particular specific location. So for insertions of DNA by genome editing, clearly GFI 187 as written now would apply. And the question still remains about the deletions and substitutions. So at this time, the agency remains in a deliberative process, and I urge you to stay tuned in. So I will now move on from talking about the regulatory and statutory authority to our current approval, review and approval process for data and information submitted to us for GE animal products. We conduct what we call a hierarchical risk-based evaluation, starting with the product definition, looking at the data submitted towards the molecular characterization of the construct or the construct in the animal. We then conduct a phenotypic evaluation for the GE animal containing the rDNA construct and then move on to further evaluations looking at the stability of the construct, both genotypically and phenotypically over multiple generations of the animals in the lineage. Where appropriate, we conduct a food feed safety evaluation, and obviously the environmental safety evaluation. Finally, the claim validation, or this would be the effectiveness evaluation. So all of this occurs in the pre-approval phase, where we are looking at the data submitted for towards an application. And then if a decision is made to approve, then there are certain sponsor responsibilities in the post-approval phase, where they work closely with the agency in identifying the appropriate processes for that as well. So I will now go over each of these steps in some detail. The product definition forms a baseline based on which we form our evaluation. So this identifies, first off, what is the construct, where is it located, what is the animal in which it's been introduced, and what is the claim intended, thank you, and what's the claim intended. So this is the baseline of our evaluation as we move up that hierarchical process to determine the hazards and risks associated with the subsequent steps of data submission. So the molecular characterization of the construct is where we start our safety evaluations. So here we are just looking at the rDNA construct as it exists in the test tube. How is this rDNA construct derived? What are the elements that it contains? Do the elements individually or in the construct, do they identify any risks associated with them? For instance, if there are any viral sequences that we use in the derivation of the construct. So we look at the data that was submitted for the entire rDNA construct before it's inserted into the animal. In the next step, we look at the rDNA construct in the animal. Do we determine, does the insertion of the rDNA construct pose any hazard to the animals themselves, to the human, or to the environment? So, and then we also do some comparisons. For instance, a sequence of the rDNA construct inserted at its particular location in the animal as compared to the rDNA construct that was intended to be present. Have there been any changes made during the insertion process? The phenotypic characterization step is the one where our animal scientists and veterinarians actually look at the animal data. So we start with the gross animal review, which would be animal health and husbandry. Are there any direct or indirect effects that have been identified, all the way down to biochemical analyses, including clinical chemistry, and just comparing the health of the animal, of the GE animal, as compared to the non-GE comparator. The durability assessment and plan is actually a two-step evaluation. So the durability assessment, just like for any traditional drug product, is the product stable? What are the stability characteristics? So we look at that both at the genotypic level, at the rDNA construct in the animal. So there's a founder animal, but is the construct stable over multiple generations in the lineage of animals as well? And what are the what are the monitoring assays that the sponsor has in place for the same? So we do that both for the genotypic evaluation and also for the phenotypic effect that the rDNA construct gives the animal, and is that effect stable as well over multiple generations. The durability plan then, even though we evaluate it and assess it in the pre-approval setting, because that's what the sponsor is using to characterize the animals over multiple generations, we then make sure that the sponsor has plans in place for post-approval quality monitoring of their animals and the product as well. So the food feed safety component becomes important in the case of food animals, where we would want to evaluate any risk of direct or indirect adverse outcomes from inserting the rDNA construct. But for a GE animal, model of human disease, that would be like a biofarm animal that is being used to produce a biopharmaceutical. These are not animals that are intended to enter into the food feed supply, neither the animals nor the animal derivatives. So in these cases, the sponsor would have to provide evidence to demonstrate that they have processes and procedures in place to make sure that animals and animal derivatives do not enter into the food or feed supply. They give this affirmative statement to the agency, and the agency also evaluates their processes and procedures. The environmental safety evaluation is the one I talked about when I mentioned NEPA earlier, that since the approval of a GE animal is a major agency action, there is an environmental assessment carried out for the GE products, and this is the basis for satisfying the NEPA requirements. So after all of the safety and stability evaluations, effectiveness. Does the GE animal meet the claim that it has been established in the product definition? Does the animal do what it was intended to do by the insertion of the rDNA construct? So this slide just contains some examples of the types of risk questions we would address for GE animal models of human disease. So for instance, the molecular evaluations and characterizations that are carried out, we would consider what is the likelihood of introduced or altered sequences recombining with endogenous sequences and posing any infectious risks. Are there a direct or indirect unintended effects on animal health? So that would be the basis for the phenotypic characterization. Since the animals are not intended to enter the food or feed supply, what are the processes the sponsor has in place for record keeping, animal ID and tracking, containment, disposition of animals and their derivatives? And is the claim valid and durable? So I will go into some of these risk questions or the types of questions in some detail in these next two hypothetical case studies. So these are completely made up examples of GE animal models of disease. So for instance, in this first case, here is a pig model of human cancer. And so what it has is a heritable site-specific insertion of a human gene that's been inserted into the pig genome, with the downstream effect being an effect on the expression levels of a chemokine receptor, such that this GE pig now serves as a model of human cancer, specifically small cell lung cancer. So with respect to the molecular characterizations, again, we would evaluate what was the editor used. So in this case, these are TALENs that were used for a site-specific insertion. So where did the insertion happen? How well has that insertion site been characterized? How does the sequence of the inserted gene compare to the rDNA construct that was used in the insertion? Are there multiple copies? You know, the location, is it as it was intended, since it was intended to be a site-specific insertion? Now this is a hypothetical case study for cattle altered for disease resistance, where again, it's a site-specific insertion of a gene for resistance to mastitis derived from buffalo and inserted into Bos taurus. So again, the molecular characterization of the construct or the construct in the animal, the questions again would be related to whatever editor was used, where it was inserted, how it was inserted, are there any sequences of concern now that the gene exists in these animals, and how detailed was the characterization that was conducted. So moving on from the molecular characterizations and evaluations, these are the kinds of things we would look at for these two case studies for the phenotypic characterization of the animals themselves. So under animal safety, we would look at growth characteristics. So again, this is comparing the GE animals to the non-GE comparators. And determine, are there any changes in the growth characteristics of these animals, the reproductive capacity, are there any intended or unintended abnormalities that are detected? The biochemical analysis for the blood chemistry of these animals, whether the GE pig or the GE cattle, and the presence of the altered protein, in this case, if the the insertion were to result in an expression off of that inserted gene affecting, say, the chemokine receptor levels in the first example. So the kinds of data and information we would look at under animal health and husbandry would be to look at how these animals are maintained, what are the conditions and care under which they are housed, the daily animal observation records, the veterinary treatment reports, especially related to any of the, for instance, if the insertion were to result in the first case of the cancer, you know, are there treatment, does the phenotype get expressed, and then what are the appropriate treatments for the intended effect, or if there were any unintended effects as a result of inserting that cancer-causing gene, and the biosurveillance practices at the facility. And as always, after completing all the safety evaluations for any of the GE animals, we would look at the claim validation or the effectiveness component of the application, as that is a requirement whereby there has to be at least one adequate and one well-controlled study in the target animal, and any supporting data that that might be presented supporting the change in the GE animal model of that intended human disease. So with that, I will end my discussion of the regulatory process and the review process. And thank you for your attention, but I would also like to direct your attention to a webinar that is being conducted under the Gene Drive series, where you might find some more information on FDA's risk analysis process for biotech products. And this is presented by Dr. Larissa Rudenko, our Senior Advisor for Biotech at CDM. Thank you.